Hi all. Well, today we're going to talk about vector calculus and Maxwell's equations. So here they are. This is the Maxwell equations, the theory of the electromagnetic field. And we better number these. The first equation on the list, equation one, says that the divergence of the electric field, and this, we'll talk about this differential operator del. It's a vector differential operator, and there are other characterizations of this equation, but this equation's in classical vector calculus, we call this the divergence of the electric field is equal to the charge density divided by a constant epsilon zero. Equation two specifies the curl of the electric field, and that's equal to the negative of the time derivative of the magnetic field. And then there's a similar pair of equations for the magnetic field. The curl of B is equal to the current density, and there's a constant in front, plus the time derivative of the electric field divided by the speed of light squared. And we're using SI units here, so meters per second is velocity, charge is in coulombs, the magnetic field is in Tesla, and the electric field is in volts per meter. Okay. Now charge density and current density enter these equations, and we'll talk about that in a minute. And then the last equation in the list here is equation four. Specifies the divergence of the magnetic field is equal to zero. So these equations constitute Maxwell's theory of the electromagnetic field. So what does that mean? It means that if you have a specified charge distribution, and these functions there's like a kind of a fluid picture of charge distribution, and these can be functions of position and time, and these are viewed as continuous functions, and so the charge is spread out in kind of a smooth fluid-like distribution. Then you have the other quantity is the current density, and this is a vector. This is measured, the units of the current density are amps, so current is measured in amperes, amps per square meter, and that's a vector. And this thing can be viewed as the charge density times a velocity field. And if you want to know what the velocity field is, and somebody gives you J and rho, then V is equal to J over rho. But usually we just specify the current density. These Maxwell's equations allow you to do the following problem. Suppose you have the current density and the charge density specified, then Maxwell's equations allow you to find what the electromagnetic field is. The idea is we're giving J, specifying J and rho somehow, and once you've done that, you can solve these four equations and find out what the electric and magnetic fields have to be consistent with the current and charge density. Okay, good. And we're going to talk about how you use vector calculus to manipulate these equations in the next part. What do we want to say? What more can we say at this point? Well, I will write down what this operator here looks like. It's called del, and there are other names for it, but mostly physicists call this del. And one way of writing this out is it's operating on the Cartesian space, three-dimensional Cartesian manifold E3, and so it's sometimes called a vector operator. So what if we had a scalar field? So a scalar field would be something like the electrostatic potential, phi of xyz. If you operate on this scalar field with del, you get this. The vector field d phi by dz and the I, j, k are the unit orthogonal Cartesian basis vectors for E3. So we have a couple of E's floating around here, but E3 is the Euclidean manifold on which we do this type of vector analysis. So I guess we can distinguish that from vector E, which is will indicate as a vector field with a little bar over it. And I'm going to use the carets to indicate quantities that are related to the manifold, the differentiable structure of E3. So look what you've got done here. You've taken a scalar field, which can be viewed as a fiber bundle, one-dimensional linear space on E3, and operating by del gives you a vector. So this quantity on the right side is a vector field, and if phi is the electrostatic potential, gives you the electrostatic field. At each point in the manifold, there is a vector E, and if E is continuous, it's a continuous section of the vector bundle on E3, where the electric field vector exists. Okay. Don't want to get into manifold theory too much, but we'll do some of that later. Okay, so this operation, when it's operating on a scalar field, is called the gradient of phi. Gradient of phi. This gives a vector pointing in the direction of fastest increase of the scalar field phi. Now, we can do some theory on these equations right away. And the first bit of theory we're going to do involves using a vector identity that involves the curl of B. So the curl of B gives you a vector. Notice the right-hand side of these equations are vectors here for curl E and curl B. So these are actually three equations in scalar variables. One equation for the divergence of E and one equation for the divergence of the magnetic field. Altogether eight equations if you write them out in scalar components. Alrighty, I want to say about this, and most important, is we observe that these equations 1 through 4 are all linear equations. That is, if you have a solution, suppose you have current density rho 1 and current density j 1, charge density 2 rho 2 and current density j 2, and you solve Maxwell's equations to get the fields E1 and B1, fields E2 and B2. If you add these up, it's also guaranteed to be a solution of these four equations. Gives you the fields E1 plus E2 and the magnetic field E1 B1 plus B2. So Maxwell's equations are linear. The kind of classical vector calculus that we're doing here was developed in the 1800s and early 1900s. The great American physicist Willard Gibbs at Yale was the guy who kind of first worked out this type of vector calculus. It's widely used, for instance, if you're taking electromagnetic theory in physics, Jackson's famous classical book, Classical Electrodynamics, they use this notation and they assume a familiarity with classical vector calculus. Classical vector calculus, we're just talking about rigorous development of these operations with the differential operator del. And notice the gradient operation here of a potential gives you a vector field. So in that sense, this gradient operator is an exterior derivative. It's taking functions in a one-dimensional vector space, phi, and converting that into a vector. So the result of this operation is exterior to the original space, one-dimensional fiber bundle where the potential exists. All right, well, let's see if we can do some theoretical physics with these equations. Is prove that these equations imply conservation of electric charge, and they actually also imply that magnetic monopoles do not exist. You can also modify these equations in case somebody discovers a magnetic monopole. We're all ready. You just put the monopole density in here, and there's a monopole current that shows up over in equation 2. Don't worry about them going obsolete if someone discovers a magnetic monopole. We can talk about that a bit later. In order to prove that charge is conserved, we're going to need a vector identity that the divergence of the curl of B, the curl of B is a vector field, a physics field, and the divergence of that field is always equal to what? The scalar zero. Let's go ahead and use this. This is very easy to prove. You may have already seen this. If you'd like to prove this identity, all you do is write out the Cartesian components of the curl, and so that's the curl. What happens when you take the divergence of this thing? Okay, so I'll just leave this as an exercise to work that out. And all you have to do is just be a little careful and don't make any sign errors. Okay, so now we're ready to do some theoretical physics. Let's take a look at the equation for the curl of B. So it's right here, equation 3, and we're going to write that out. And by the way, if you are a physics student, it's a good idea to just memorize these four equations. And in SI units is a good thing. You can also dimensionless units, but this is sort of the practical unit that people understand. And for instance, your electronic instruments are all calibrated in volts and amps, not in stat volts or stat coulombs or anything. Although magnetic fields are often given in, well, what's called Gaussian units, actually, is the Gauss. And one Gauss is equal to 10 to the minus 4 Tesla. Anything else on units? The units can be kind of tricky if start seeing these in different systems of units, but we're sticking with SI units. Okay, so we have this vector identity over here, so let's go ahead and just take the divergence of this equation here. So the divergence of the left-hand side, the curl of B, it's this term here, that is equal to zero. And now we're going to take the divergence of the right-hand side, and let's see what that gives you. The divergence of J, so this is the divergence of the current density, plus 1 over c squared, divergence operator comes inside the time derivative, and you have the divergence of the electric field over here. We have this equation right here, pretty interesting. It says that the divergence of the current plus the time derivative of the divergence of the electric field is zero. Now, does this look familiar? Sure it does. We've memorized Maxwell's equations by now, and everybody knows that this divergence is equal to the charge density. So, you have this equation, current density and the charge density, over epsilon zero. The epsilon zero and mu zero are constants, are related to the speed of light here once you've canceled out all the constants. So it says the time derivative of the charge density plus the divergence of the current density is always equal to zero. And this is local conservation of electric charge. So Maxwell's equations tell you something kind of cosmological or more general significance. Embedded in those equations is the law of conservation of electric charge. Now, maybe it's not so obvious that this is, why do I say that's conservation of electric charge? So one way to see that that's the case is to use Gauss's divergence theorem. And Gauss's theorem says that if you take the volume integral of the divergence of J over some volume V, that's equal to the surface integral over the surface. I'm going to just call this the surface associated with this volume V. That's equal to the surface integral of J inner product with the surface element. This is called the flux of J. If you integrate over the whole area of the surface, the total amount of J leaving the surface is what you get when you do this integral, plus the volume integral of time derivative of the volume integral of the charge density, rho dV, 0. And this volume integral of the charge density distribution is equal to the total charge, Q, total number of coulombs inside the volume V. I'll just call this Q sub V. And so you can write this out as the time derivative of the charge inside the volume V is equal to the minus of the flux of J. So we can do this pictorially. Here's a volume, a little spherical volume here, and there's some charge inside. Okay, and this surface, and there's this volume inside here, V, and it says that the time rate of change, Q dot, is equal to minus this flux of J. See if we can come up with a nice physical picture of why this is telling you the charge is conserved. So it says the time rate of change of the charge inside this sphere, let's say, the minus outflow of charge. So here is J coming out of the volume, and so if the current is leaving this volume across the surface, the total amount of current leaving the volume is the integral of this current over the surface, and it's telling you if current is leaving the volume, then the charge enclosed, it must be going down. It has a negative time derivative. So that's why this equation here is telling you locally, in any infinitesimal volume or any large volume, no matter how large you want, it says that electric charge is conserved if Maxwell's equations are true. So that's a pretty cool result. You know, you could think of it as having consequences on the cosmological scale even. We've done our first bit of theoretical physics. Local charge conservation is implied by Maxwell's equations. Now, one more thing I should say about charge conservation. There is another property of Maxwell's equations. They are gauge invariant. That is, you can obtain a family of fields that solve the equation by adding gradients of a scalar field and time derivatives of a scalar field appropriately. And that type of addition, when you add on this gauge field, is called a gauge transformation. And equations like Maxwell's equations here and other field theories that are gauge field theories are invariant under this gauge transformation. And it turns out that if the theory is gauge invariant, its charge quantities are conserved. Finally, I want to notice that we have a similar set of equations for the magnetic field, and the fact that the divergence of B is always equal to zero is telling you, let's put it this way, there's no such thing in Maxwell's theory as a magnetic monopole. So you might imagine, what would that look like if you had a unit of magnetic charge, a magnetic monopole density? And so you'd modify these equations and put in the density of monopoles over here, and there'd be a similar term in here, I guess the monopole current density would show up in this curl equation for the electric field. Not sure about the sign right off the bat. You know, it's possible that someday people will discover a magnetic monopole, but it's generally believed that they will obey Maxwell's equations with just adding in a monopole charge density and a monopole current density. This property of gauge invariance, which we'll talk about later, is another way of obtaining conservation of charge. But Maxwell's equations, as they stand, imply conservation of electric charge, this equation here, and they also say that we're not going to talk about any magnetic monopoles. The magnetic monopole density is zero And since magnetic monopoles are conserved, there's no current, there's no magnetic monopole current either. Okay, so, well, why don't we stop there? I hope you enjoyed this brief startup on vector calculus and Maxwell's equations. We'll talk more about this in the next video, where we obtain the wave equation for the electromagnetic field, and we'll enhance our vector calculus SAG of tricks a bit more. Hope you enjoyed this video. Thanks for watching.